the fragrance of selfless love that has drawn the world into one family. The truth of an eternal message that has been revealed through every act and word. The fulfillment in service that has been taught by relentless sacrifice. The Lord's own life is indeed His message.
Sai Ram, greetings and welcome to the 19th episode of our month-long tele-serial, The Message of the Lord. In yesterday's episode, we had a broad overview of how Swami provided access to safe drinking water to over 2 million people spread across 3 districts in Andhra Pradesh, making hardships a distant and dim memory. Today, we shall continue along the same theme, that is, providing safe drinking water to large groups of people in a manner that is unprecedented in any part of the world where individual effort is concerned. Specifically, we shall be dealing about 2 projects, the Godavari Drinking Water Supply Project and supply of safe drinking water to the large metro city Chennai, formerly known as Madras.
Chennai, as it is now known, was originally a small fishing village. In 1640, ships of the British East India Company landed there, and through negotiations, the British managed to get some land where they built a fort. Slowly, as British traders expanded their influence and changed from traders to colonizers, they established an entire city, of which Fort St. George became the headquarters. While the city of Madras steadily grew, it also began to have a growing water problem since there was no major river nearby. All it could do was to depend on the fickle northeast monsoon and store whatever water they got from rain in several reservoirs. By the middle of the 20th century, it became clear that the only long-term solution for Chennai was to somehow bring water from the distant Krishna River. After much talk and a lot of feet dragging by many, it was finally agreed between the state of Andhra Pradesh, through which the Krishna flowed, and the state of Tamil Nadu, of which Chennai was the capital, that a special canal would be built to bring Krishna River to Chennai. As far as Tamil Nadu was concerned, the operative part of the canal was the link from the Kandaleru Reservoir to the Pundi Reservoir near Chennai. Most of the link, about 150 kilometers long, would be in Andhra, the last 25 kilometers or so in Tamil Nadu. The Andhra government agreed to build the canal up to the Tamil Nadu border, from where a special canal to be dug by the Tamil Nadu government would take the Krishna water to the Pundi. That was the deal. The project was formally inaugurated in 1984 with a lot of sound bites and promises. 12 years later, the project was formally declared open. The thirsty people of Chennai said to themselves, "Thank God, at last all our problems are over." Unfortunately, it did not work out that way. Firstly, water released into the Kandaleru Pundi Canal, the vital waterway that was supposed to be the lifeline of Chennai, hardly reached the metro city. Every year, Tamil Nadu was supposed to get 12 TMC of water. 1 TMC represents 1,000 million cubic feet or 1 billion cubic feet. For 5 years in a row, only about 1 or 2 TMC reached Chennai per year. At times, less than 1 TMC when Chennai was supposed to get 12. Added to this was the fact that for 5 years in a row, the northeast monsoon had also failed miserably. No wonder Chennai was hit with a drought, the like of which that crowded city had never witnessed before. The metropolitan authorities had to bring water to various places by tankers. But that was not enough. Thus it was that private operators entered the business, making water an expensive commercial commodity, too costly for the poor.
தண்ணி எடுக்கிறதுனால வந்து எனக்கு வந்து ஸ்டடீஸ் அஃபெக்ட் ஆகுது.
இங்கே தண்ணி கஷ்டத்தால் ரொம்ப பாதிக்கணும். கொஞ்ச நேரம் நிம்மதியாக தூங்க முடியல. பண கஷ்டம்.
எல்லாருக்குமே தண்ணி கஷ்டன்றது எல்லாருக்குமே இருக்கு. இது என்னைக்கு சால்வ் ஆகும்னு தெரியல.
தண்ணி எடுக்கிறதா நான் வேலைக்கு போகிறதா என்ன சரினு எனக்கு ஒன்றும் புரியல.
தண்ணி வந்து சில நாளில் காலைல 3 மணிக்கு வந்துடுது. அதனால் நாங்கள் அதாவது 2 மணிலேருந்து தூங்காமல் சில நாள்லாம் எதிர்பார்த்துட்டு இருக்கேன். சில நாள் திடீர்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா காலையில் 8 மணிக்கு வரும். அதனால் ரொம்ப கஷ்டமாக இருக்கும்.
அந்த தண்ணியில் சமைச்சு கொடுக்குற சாப்பாடு நல்லா சுத்தமாக இருக்க மாட்டேங்குது. குழந்தைங்களுக்கு வயிற்று வலி பேதிலாம் வருது. இதுக்காக மழை வந்தால் நல்லாயிருக்கும். இதுக்காக சாயராம்கிட்ட நாங்கள் ப்ரே பண்ணுறோம்.
See, because of the water problem, the traffic has become very, very congested. All are blocked by the lorries. So we are getting a lot of accident cases. We get a lot of diseases like sporadic cases of typhoid and cholera, and diarrhea. Water is contaminated.
About a few weeks ago, I admitted a man with chest pain. You know what brought about his chest pain? He had to carry this kodams of water up to his flat, which is on the third floor. Many buildings don't have lifts up to the third floor. And he had to carry this water up, and he was a hypertensive, and this too in the middle of the night because they don't know when the thanni lorry will come. Okay, and he developed chest pain. So you see how something like water shortage can lead to even a heart attack. Financial health is devastated. Most middle class families end up spending more than 1,000 rupees a month. This is the fundamental need which has to be addressed. My husband and I also work in certain homes for destitute people. In one such home, we're getting water from the villages in tankers. One fine day, suddenly all the inmates turned blue because the water from the village areas was contaminated with nitrates, which is there in the fertilizer. Nitrate contaminated water can result in a poisoning known as methemoglobinemia. The inmates all started turning blue. I got a frantic call at night. I slept the whole night in that home. Luckily, by God's grace, we were able to rush the badly affected people to some ICU in some hospitals, and they all survived. Everybody survived. There was no casualty, all recovered. But just look at that. Contamination of water. So we're facing a lot of problems.
Let's go back to the Kandaleru Pundi canal, which was to provide the ultimate solution. That canal was no canal, but one long lousy ditch. It simply had not been built the way it ought to have been. Swami, being the embodiment of compassion, soon came to the rescue of the people of Chennai. In typical Baba fashion, he made a dramatic announcement of his resolve to provide drinking water to Chennai, when no one, least of all the citizens of Chennai, expected it. It all happened on 19th January 2002, when Swami was in Bangalore to attend the first anniversary of the Bangalore Super Speciality Hospital. And there, in the midst of his discourse, Swami took everyone by surprise.
ఈనాడు పవిత్రమైనటువంటి యొక్క ఈ సమయమునందు నేను మరొకటి కూడా సంకల్పించుకున్నాను. మద్రాస్ రాష్ట్రం లోపల త్రాగడానికి నీరు లేదు. ఏదో ధనవంతులు లారీలతోనో లేక బండ్లతోనో తెప్పించుకొని త్రాగలుగుతున్నారు. ఈ బీద ప్రజలు ఏ నీటిని కొనుక్కోగలరు? ఏ రీతిగా తన ప్రాణాన్ని నిలుపుకోగలరు? కనుకనే వర్షంతో పడినటువంటి ఆ గుంతల్లో నీరు త్రాగి ఆరోగ్యాన్ని పాడు చేసుకుంటున్నారు. కనుకనే ఎంత నష్టమైనా సరియే, ఎంత కష్టమైనా సరియే, మెడ్రాస్ కంతా కూడాను మంచి నీరు అందించాలని నేను సంకల్పించుకుంటున్నాను. ఇది తప్పక నెరవేరుతుంది, దీనికి సందేహమే లేదు. ఆ దృఢమైనటువంటి విశ్వాసాన్ని మానవుడు అభివృద్ధి పరచుకోవాలి.
Almost immediately following his historic announcement, Swami instructed the Sri Satya Sai Central Trust to get busy and rejuvenate the existing canal using the latest in modern technology. The entire work was completed in about a year, and water from the Krishna River finally started flowing towards Chennai on Swami's birthday in 2004. At last, after waiting for years, the people of Chennai got the much needed relief. The slum dwellers have no pipes in their huts, but have pumps connected to the water lines below ground. For years, the poor living in the slums faced a desperate situation. Thanks to Bhagavan, the nightmare is finally over.
With Swami's infinite grace and blessings, the residents of Chennai and the neighboring districts are getting water through the Satya Sai Ganga Water Project. As a result of this, the incidence of diseases carried through water are coming down, and we find that the people are suffering less and less from waterborne diseases. This is indeed a great blessing for all of us.
தனிப்பட்ட ஒரு பிளஸிங்ஸ் தான் மெட்ராஸ் மெட்ரோவுக்கு வாட்டரே கிடச்சிருக்கு, அதில் சந்தேகமே இல்லை.
சுவாமி வந்து இந்த சாயி கங்கை சாய் கங்கைங்கிற பிரேம கங்கையில் எங்கள் எல்லாரையும் முழுகடிச்சுட்டார்.
நான் இதை ஃபஸ்ட் தடவை வந்திருக்கேன். சாய் பாபாவோட அனுகிரகத்தினால ரொம்ப நல்ல விதமாக இது பண்ணியிருக்கு. எங்களுக்கு சென்னை மக்களுக்கு தண்ணி கொடுத்ததில் வந்து சாய் பாபாவுக்கு 100 தடவை 1000 தடவை அவ்வளோ தேங்க்ஸ் சொல்லுவோம்.
தண்ணி கூட குடிக்க இல்லாமல் அப்படி நாங்கள் கஷ்டப்படுறச்சே பகவான் வந்து ஹெல்ப் பண்ணி எங்களுக்கு இன்றைக்கி சாய் கங்கா ப்ராஜெக்ட் பண்ணி ரொம்ப ஹெல்ப் பண்ணியிருக்காரு. அது கோடி கோடி பிரணாம் பாபாவுக்கு.
Never the one to rest, Swami launched yet another drinking water project. This time, it was by harnessing the waters of the majestic river Godavari. For centuries, this river has been emptying itself into the Bay of Bengal. Much water flowed through Godavari. Yet, villagers living nearby, most of whom were tribals, had to struggle for drinking water. Swami became very concerned about their plight and resolved to come to their rescue.
ఇప్పుడు మీ పశ్చిమ గోదావరికి ఈస్ట్ గోదావరికి మేము 60 కోట్లు పెట్టి నీరిస్తున్నాం. నాకు ఎందుకంటే అన్నం లేకపోయినా కానీ ఉండొచ్చును, కానీ నీరు లేకపోతే ఉండడానికి వీలు కాదు. కాబట్టి నీరు చాలా అవసరం. ఇంత గోదావరికి ప్రక్కనే ఉంటున్నారు, తాగడానికి నీరు లేదు. ఇట్లా ఉంటుండాలి. అన్నీ దగ్గర ఉండి కూడాను అనుభవించుకోవడానికి అవకాశం లేకుండా ఉంటుండాలి. మనిషి ప్రయత్నం కూడా చాలా అవసరము.
Once again, a crisp directive to the Sri Satya Sai Central Trust. This time, it was to provide safe drinking water to about 550 villages in East and West Godavari districts, flanking the river as it makes its way to the sea. In principle, the scheme was simple. Draw water from the river via intake wells, purify and then distribute. In practice, however, the execution was far from simple because much of the area is heavily forested. In this respect, the Godavari drinking water project turned out to be quite different from all the earlier ones executed. As in all of Swami's projects, work proceeded fast. By Swami's 80th birthday in November 2005, nearly 80% of the project was over. And in a symbolic gesture, purified drinking water was supplied to a few villages shortly after Swami's 80th birthday. Since then, the Godavari drinking water project has been completed, as always, in record time.
Do you know what a tribal woman did when she heard that Swami was going to give them water? She gave away 1 acre of her land and a pumping station was built on the land she gifted, so that her people would be benefited. This is what is called having a large heart, and that is what sharing and caring really means. We are now in another tribal village, and this is how this lady is expressing her gratitude to Swami. By the way, much later, to be precise, on June 2009, a big group of these tribals came to Prashanthi Nilayam to express their gratitude and also sing and dance for Swami. And remember that lady who sang that song of gratitude? She now gets a chain from Swami. He never forgets, you know. At this stage, we would like to raise the level of discussion by reflecting on the larger issue of God, man, and water.
Now, 3/4 of the planet Earth is covered with water. However, 97% of the water on Earth exists as salt water in the oceans. And only 3% of the water available on Earth is fresh water. This 3% of fresh water is distributed between many agencies. 3/4 of the fresh water on Earth is locked up in icebergs and glaciers. Of the rest of the fresh water on Earth, water vapor in the atmosphere accounts for 0.36%. The water in lakes and rivers also accounts for a small amount, a mere 0.34%. The rest of the fresh water exists below as groundwater, and this amounts to 25% of the 3% of all the water on Earth. Fresh water on Earth is constantly recycled. The journey starts from the ocean through evaporation. Clouds then form and come down as rain. In high altitudes and in the colder regions, the precipitation is as snow. Snow melts and feeds streams and rivers. Finally, rivers merge with the ocean, completing the cycle. The amount of fresh water available for man to draw and use is fixed. Few appreciate that the amount of fresh water available 100 years ago is the same as the amount of fresh water available now, and that it is this same amount that would be available 100 years later also. This is a major source of worry, since the population of the world is continually increasing, while the fresh water available remains fixed. Meanwhile, the demand for water is constantly increasing. A long time ago, water was needed only for drinking, domestic use, and agriculture. Today, industry is consuming a lot of water. Public utilities like hotels, airports, and railway stations also consume a lot of water. People who have ready access to water take it for granted and fail to appreciate how precious it is.
Incidentally, when we withdraw water, not all of it is properly used. Only a part of it is used, and the rest of it is either wasted or polluted. What is the take-home lesson from Swami's water projects? Well, there are many. Firstly, water being a necessity of life, everyone has a duty not only to be careful about water, that is, not waste or pollute it, but also to be fair in sharing it with fellow human beings. It cannot be that some people grab water and use it for sustaining their luxury lifestyle, while others struggle even for drinking water. Next, wasting water is criminal. Thirdly, we must all be humble and reverential enough to realize that compassionate God has given water free. Don't we therefore owe Him something? Indeed, and the best way to discharge that debt is to do whatever we can to mitigate the water problems of those who are not so fortunate. Incidentally, Swami has Himself shown us the way. For example, He sends a water truck to many villages that are not connected to the Ananthapur drinking water scheme. In short, it is only when we see God in air, water, and food, the three basic requirements for sustaining life, would we stop polluting air and water and adulterating food.
Every individual is the form of God, and since society is the macro of the individual, society automatically becomes the macro form of God. And it is in order to stress on this point that Swami has established so many massive drinking water supply projects. Swami is telling us, don't think that the government alone must do such jobs. Of course, it is the government's duty and responsibility to execute such projects. But if they fail to do so, do we leave man to his fate? No, because when our fellow beings suffer, we suffer, for God is in all. Swami is telling us that we need not do mega projects, but we can be compassionate and try to do things in our own little way. With this message, we come to the end of this episode. Hope you are enjoying this series and do join us tomorrow for the next episode. Thank you. Jai Sairam.